So this presentation is called "What's It All About? SAS Viya for Python Users." So the aim of this presentation is to demonstrate how your Python users in your organization can utilize the power of SAS Viya in an environment and language that they're very used to. So we'll start off with a brief introduction to SAS Viya. We'll move on to connecting to SAS Viya via Python, and we'll then read some data into a CAS library. Once we've done this, we'll then have a look at exploring our data using Python code, manipulating our data, again, using Python code, and then finally, we'll look at visualizing our data. And within, we can do this within Python code and also using different tools which are available within SAS Viya, such as SAS Visual Analytics. So I'll start off with a brief introduction to SAS Viya. So today we're going to be looking at using the Jupyter Notebook, or Jupyter Lab, which is an open source programming interface which was first developed and released in 2018. It integrates three main languages, Julia, Python, and R, into a single interface. SAS Viya is also going to be used, which is now open and accessible to multiple programming languages. So we can use the capabilities of Python, Java, and Lua, and access SAS Viya directly using these languages now. Why would we want to do this? Well, it allows us to have a single analytics data store, which is no longer just accessible to our SAS coders, but it's also open and accessible to those within Python, within Java, and within Lua as well. And this will enable us to enforce a centralized governance of the platform as well. So how do we connect to SAS Viya? Well, within Python, we need access to some additional packages. And the main package that we need access to is something called SWAT, which is a scripting wrapper for analytics transfer. Now, if we install this package, it just gives us extra functionality to our Python session. So now we will be able to launch SAS Viya sessions, load some data into CAS. We can connect and modify our data that's stored in CAS, and we can also perform some visualizations on it. Now, if you want to use the full functionality of this, you may need some additional packages. So two that I've chosen to use on top of, as well as SWAT, include Pandas, which is a data analysis and manipulation package, and also Matplotlib, which is a 2D plotting library. So we can use this to create things such as histograms, box plots, those kind of visualizations. Once you've installed these packages on top of your Python distribution, to gain access to them within your, in your Python session, you need to import them into your session. Now for SWAT, it's as simple as typing the keywords import SWAT. If you want to import pandas, I've chosen to use an alias within this, so we can use PD to call that package. That just means that I can specify the package I would like to use for any particular functions that I want to use within Python. Finally, importing matplotlib, I've chosen to use a .ply plot up there, which is a little bit different. All that means is I just want a subset of that package. I don't want to import the whole thing, just a small amount of it into my session. So now we've imported our packages into our Python session, we can now connect to SAS Viya. And to connect to SAS Viya, all we need to run is a simple connection statement, which has four main arguments. So we've got the CAS host, or the host name that we would like to connect to, which is the name of our SAS Viya server. A port, by default, this will be 5570, but talk to your administrator if you've got some kind of custom configuration for that. And then finally, you've got the user ID and a password to secure the connection. Now, when I run this command initially, you won't see any output within the output window. And that's just a feature of Python. It doesn't give you any information on this. So if I want to check that my connection is successful, I can run something called a server status method within Python. And this just gives me information about the environment that I've connected to. And it just lists it below the code cell, and that just verifies that my connection was successful. So far, we've connected to SAS Viya. So now let's look at loading some data into my SAS Viya server. To load data, SWAT contains a number of different methods that we can use for this. Now, I've chosen to use the upload file method. And the only reason I've chosen this method over some of the others is because it's very flexible. So I can use it for CSV files, SAS data sets, even Excel files, I can upload them using this method. Within the upload file method, there are two main arguments. Firstly, the data argument, which is the location where the data is stored on the SAS Viya server. And secondly, there's a CAS out argument. Now, within the CAS out argument, there are also additional options which we can add, which are they're optional within here. And I've chosen to add three of these as part of a dictionary statement, something that any Python user would be completely familiar with. And the three that I've chosen to add include name, which in this case is the name of the data that I would like to load up to my CAS server. The CAS library that I would like to load that data into, I've chosen to use the CAS user library for this. And then finally, I've added a third option within there, which is called a replace option. And this just means that it will replace the data if it already exists within CAS. By default, this is set to false because it's not a good idea to replace your data unless you know you definitely want to do that. When I run the code, it just gives me the information about this underneath the code cell. So this, you would see this within the interface itself. So you can see there within the log that we've got the student's performance data set, which has been loaded, and it's been created in the library called CAS user. Okay. Now, if I would like to view this data, it's as simple as running a head method on the data set. So now I've just run the head method, I can see the first 10 observations in my data set. So I think this is a good point to introduce the data itself. So I'm guessing you've probably worked it out already. The data set's called Students' Performance. It's just general information about a number of students that are going through three main exams. So the information includes that of gender, their race and ethnicity, and other different information in there, so we can categorize the data itself. In addition to this, we've got scores for three exams, including a math score, reading score, and a writing score. Now, it's important to note at this point that these values are percentages, so we're expecting these values to be out of 100. So let's have a look and explore this data a little bit further. So a great place to start when you want to explore your data is to use things like histograms. And to create a histogram within Python, it's as simple as running the hist method. Now, by default, within Python, this is going to create me a histogram for each numeric variable within my CAS table, as so. So I've got one for math score, one for reading score, and one for writing score. Now, I mentioned previously the scores that were within there are out of 100. Now, if we look a little bit closer at the reading score in the middle there, we can see that the x-axis of that histogram goes well above 100. So there's some kind of data quality issue there that we need to address. So let's have a look at this a bit closer. So if I want to find out where this value is, what's wrong with this data, we know there's something in there that's above 100 within my data set. Well, I can use that head method that we saw earlier, again. And I'm going to use that with a filter of the data now. So I've filtered the data, I just want to look at that reading score within my data set, and then we can just look at those values which are above 100 within our data set. And within Jupyter Notebook or Jupyter Lab, it will just display the row that's within there. Now we can see within this row that's been identified that the reading score is 120. Now we know it's a percentage, so that must be incorrect. You can't score 120 in a math test. Or reading test, sorry. So what do we want to do with this? So in this case, I'm going to replace that value temporarily with a missing. Now that might not be an ideal situation, but in this case, I just want to do that so that I can impute that value later. We know it's wrong, so we might as well take it out. Now SWAT contains a method called the replace method, which can do just that. It's as simple as deciding which column I would like to apply this method to. So I want to apply this method to the reading score column. And then within the brackets, I've specified the value that I would like to find, or the value that I would like to replace. So where that 120 is found within my data set. And then I want to replace it with this value of pd.np.nam. Now that is just a Python missing. Any Python coders in here would probably know that already. And then finally within there, I've included this in-place equals true, which just allows me to replace it directly within the data set. Now if I rerun that filter that we saw before, no observations are pulled through. So we've fixed that, we've removed it. Now, we've just replaced that with a missing value, so we know that there are now missing values within our data set. So maybe that's something we should look at addressing. The histogram there from that. So we know that there are definitely missing values within our data set. So if I want to identify any missings or identify any columns within there that have got missing values, I can use the info method. And the info method gives me information on the column names, the number of values that are within my data set, and finally the type of those as well. So looking at this, we were expecting our reading score to have at least one missing value, but it turns out there must be a lot more in there as well. Also, my writing score seems to have missing values as well. So we can see that in there. So what do we want to do to fix this? Well, I'm going to impute those values. And again, within Python, we can use a method called the fillNA method, which can be used to impute these values. And this has three main options. Either I can impute the values with the missings with a specific number, I can forward fill it or backward fill it with the previous or next value within that column, or I can use something, a statistic, for example, the mean, the median, or mode on that data. In this example, I've chosen to use the median to impute this. And to impute this, all we need to do is to apply the fillNA method to the values that we would like. I've chosen to apply this to the whole table. The only reason I've chosen that is because we've got two columns which have missing values, and it will just apply it to both columns. So both those columns are going to be imputed with the median. Now, if we rerun that info method that we saw previously, there's no longer any missing values. Okay. So all of the processing that I've completed so far has been completed in my own CAS user library. Now, this library is only accessible to a single user, me. So if I want to make this available to other users, I can promote that data to a public CAS library. And this doesn't just make it available to multiple users, but also to multiple applications. The users will then have further options for what they would like to do with the data from this point onwards. Either they can continue to code within Python, if they're familiar with that, or they can switch over to some SAS Viya products. So maybe they want to have a look at SAS Visual Analytics, SAS Model Manager, or SAS Visual Data Mining and Machine Learning. Also, in addition to this, your SAS users can also now work on this data within SAS Studio. And I've manipulated all of this data within Python so far. To promote it, there is a simple CAS action for that. It's called the Promote CAS action. And all we need to specify within this action is the name of the Python object that we would like to promote, the target library, so the library that I would like to send this data to. I've chosen to use the public library. It could be any library that's accessible to multiple users. And finally, a target, which is just the name of the table, the CAS table that we would like to create in this new library. So now I'm creating the student modified data set within my public CAS library. Okay. So that should now be available within SAS Viya for all of the different products that we've got that I've just mentioned. Now, if I want to continue to work on this within Python, it's something I'm very familiar with, so I just want to continue using that. I can just connect to this library using a simple CAS table method. And all you need to specify on this method is the name of the table that you would like to connect to and the library that it's stored in. So the student modified table within the public library. Now, when you run this statement, you don't get any output, as with quite a few of these commands. So to check that the connection is successful, we can run the info method or the head method. They'll all give us information about that table. Now, the info method gives me more information because it also tells me which CAS table I've connected to. So there you can see it's a student modified table within the public CASlib. Well, what does this allow me to do? Well, now I've got multiple options for my visualizations, and I just want to demonstrate how you can create visualizations within Python as well as in SAS Visual Analytics. So Python box plots can be created using a box plot method. A simple box plot is created by specifying a column that you would like to use. And I've also added an optional by in there. I want to have a look at the math score by the parental level of education within the dataset. Now, the default box plot looks like this. Now, it's not the best and it's not the most visually appealing box plot that you can have. Now, with a bit more coding, and it does get a little bit more complicated, I can add in some additional options into that, such as patch artist, and add some different definitions into there to create this version, which does look a bit better, but to me it seems like a lot of coding really for that. Alternatively, as a Python user, I could just switch across to SAS Visual Analytics now. And I can create the exact same box plot in Visual Analytics with just three clicks. Firstly, I just choose the data that I would like to connect to or like to use within the available tab. Double click on the box plot from the objects tab. And then drag and drop the data onto the visualization. And it creates me this. And it looks exactly the same. And there's no reason why a Python user couldn't pick this up and do the same methods within here. I can also create scatter graphs. Now, the code to create this just needs a y-axis, an x-axis, a y-axis, and then the type of chart that you would like. So if I want to plot the writing score and reading score, you can see the two there within Python and SAS Visual Analytics. And they're very, very similar. They're exactly the same, same results, just slightly different displays. Okay. So the possibilities are endless, and you can have a true collaboration across a unified analytics platform. So what we've actually done is had a look at reading in raw data. Now, if I want to read in, for example, a CSV file, a SAS dataset, maybe an Excel file, there are now two options for me to do this. There's actually more than this, but there's two options which I've presented within here. Firstly, I can use Python to do this. I could read the data directly into CAS using SWAT. Or I can have a look at SAS Data Explorer to manage the data. And you can drag and drop the data directly into the interface to upload it into CAS. When I want to manipulate my data, I want to impute some values, rename them, that kind of. Within Python, we can use SWAT. We can have a look at pandas to do this. Or we can use SAS Data Studio to prepare the data. When I want to explore and visualize my data, so I've got box plots, heat maps, pie charts, I've just shown you that we can do that in both Python and SAS Visual Analytics. Now, there are other packages which you can use for this, such as Seaborn, available within Python, that can create different visualizations that you can customize. Finally, something I've not covered in this presentation, but we can also model the data. So you can create decision trees, neural networks, forecasting and regression. And within Python, there are packages to do this, like scikit-learn and TensorFlow are available for you to utilize. In addition to this, we could also switch over to Model Studio at this point and use the custom projects which are available within there. Now, you don't have to work in these side by side. You can switch across at any point. There's no reason why you can't start reading your data into using Python code and then switch across to SAS Data Studio to prepare the data and then switch back again. There's nothing stopping you doing that. So it is true collaboration across the platform. Okay, so what have we achieved today? Well, I've given you a brief introduction to SAS Viya. We've then connected to SAS Viya, read data into a CAS library. We've explored it, manipulated it, and visualized it. All of this has been done within Python code. There's no SAS code knowledge here at all. So I'm hoping that I've managed to demonstrate that SAS Viya can fully enable SAS and Python coders to collaborate in a unified platform. Okay, any questions?